The season 3 of That Time I Got Reincarnated as a Slime has been really enjoyable so far, providing everyone with plenty of world-building details, and for the newly released episode 4, it's actually very important for the overall story as it serves to set up some of the future plot points. That's why in today's video, I will not only discuss about the cut content and differences between the episode and the light novel, but why the meeting involving Rimuru and his subordinates in the episode was so important as well. As usual, a spoiler warning for anyone that hasn't watched the episode yet or might find the cut content information I mentioned to be spoilers. And if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to leave a like, subscribe to the channel, and share it with your friends. To start, Season 3 Episode 4 is titled Each Respective Roles, and it covers the contents found in Chapter 2 of the Volume 7 light novel, still being a continuation of the meeting that took place at the end of the previous Episode 3 after Rimuru has revealed his plans to organize a festival to his executives. In any case, Rimuru listened to another report from Sowear. This time it was about his survey of the monster ecology surrounding Tempest so that they can implement the proper countermeasures depending on Sowear's report. That's because they had to ensure the safety of the travelers that were currently visiting the city, and also to prevent any future incident that might implicate them, especially when Rimuru plans on organizing a festival that would attract even more people to the Monster Nation. It was for this reason that Rimuru was being extra cautious, and this wasn't mentioned in the episode but in the light novel. He was worried because he knows that the inhabitants of Tempest were all high-level monsters such as Fair Onis and High Orcs. And even though they say they are restraining their own magic use, they are still leaking out some percentage of their aura to the surroundings, which in turn will result in the birth of harmful monsters. However, Sowear would report that he has managed to deal with the more dangerous monsters in the forest like the Sword Grizzly, a monster at the rank of A-, and despite Gopta's complaints, Hakuro and the others jokingly ask him to simply train harder. Also in the anime, we see that Benimaru, Sowear, Hakuro, Kurobe and Shuna were classified as Fair Onis except for Shion, who is actually a Wicked Oni. And to explain why Shion is different from the others, in the previous season when Rimuru resurrected her, he had mixed in the magic use from Diablo's two demon subordinates, which added a demonic element to the process and paired that with the negative emotions Shion felt during her death. It caused her evolution to diverge from her fellow Onis, causing her to evolve into a Wicked Oni instead. And this was never really explained properly in the anime regarding the Fair Onis and Wicked Oni. Now back to Gopta, in the light novel, Rimuru would then explain to Sowear, Benimaru and Hakuro on how they should not use themselves as a reference point when gauging the strength of someone. Rather, they need to learn to be more considerate and open-minded, because it might discourage others to perform better or reducing the productivity of their own subordinates. That's why Rimuru even told them to learn from Gale and Gaburu on how to treat their subordinates, and honestly, the anime should have kept this dialogue point because Benimaru, Sowear and Hakuro would acknowledge this lesson and it would have provided some nice character development from them. Moving on, Rimuru was still worrying about the issue with the monster spawning despite being reassured by Sowear, so Kaiji and Vesta would provide Rimuru with the solution he needed. They basically revealed to him the magic generator prototype they had managed to create thanks to help from Gaburu, Kurobe and Shuna. And to briefly explain the function of the device, it mainly takes the magic use leaking from the monster inhabitants of Tempest, then converting it into magical energy that is used to power an anti-monster barrier that prevents monsters from entering the roads, while also helping to reduce the magic use concentration of the city. But much of what they both explained to Rimuru in the episode about the magic generator pretty much followed the light novel, with only a few minor details missing. For instance, when Kaijin stated that magic crystals will be used as batteries for devices that are placed in areas where the magic use concentrations are low, he provided an additional explanation on how he has managed to install a system within the device that allows it to convert the residue produced from the absorbed magic use into magic crystals, so that they can sell the accumulated magic crystals to the Freedom Association, since they have the technology needed to process the crystals into magic stones. But that wasn't all. Kaijin also revealed that he was currently doing research on the principles behind the processing of magic crystals into magic stones, and they might be able to create their own magic stones in the future using the magic generator. So following that explanation, it was interesting how the magic generator was based on the principles of a record player, and the anime definitely had fun depicting Rimuru being excited about the endless possibilities of this new invention. That's why he was so quick to approve of the mass production. And the importance of this invention wasn't only to lower the magic use concentration of tempers and decreasing the spawn rate of monsters, it also lessens the likelihood of humans suffering from magic use poisoning, allowing more people to stay or visit the city and helping to further Rimuru's dream of creating a nation where anyone can live in. Also, when Valdra gets excited about the idea of being able to finally release his magic use thanks to the magic generator, he gets berated by Rumuru, and even though he tries to explain how difficult it was to keep suppressing his magic use, Rumuru immediately dismisses him. I guess Valdra really is the punching bag of Tentura, but luckily Diablo gave our Whip Dragon some well-deserved recognition. Because Valdra is said to possess the second largest amount of magic use among the true dragons, so having to suppress it all is in fact quite impressive. And this detail does actually play into a future plot point when the festival eventually starts. Anyways, returning to the meeting room, it was hilarious the anime still maintains the running gag of Gopta sleeping at meetings, but this time seeing him getting punished for it was even funnier. That said, when Rumuru presents Geld with the plans to Millennium's new Sky Castle and giving the responsibility of the construction project to him, the anime actually leaves out a large portion of the conversation that happens in the light novel prior to this sequence. Essentially, when Rumuru was about to conclude the meeting, Geld had requested permission from him to visit and check on the High Orc villagers that are spread out across the Great Jura Forest, wanting to inform them about Rumuru's ascension into a Demon Lord and to transport the ones who wishes to serve Rumuru. But in reality, those were simply excuses. Geld only wants to bring in more High Orcs because they are easier to coordinate through thought communication, and with the amount of construction projects he was handling, he decided it would be more efficient. However, Rumuru quickly saw through Geld's motives, so he rejected the request because he wanted Geld to improve his leadership skills by managing other races without relying on convenient methods to resolve an issue, and he doesn't want the culture of preferential treatment for their own kind manifesting in tempers. That's why in the anime, Geld was worried about failing such a significant and important project because Rumuru had ordered him to work with the prisoners, but to prevent him from being overwhelmed, Kaijin along with Maya would be helping him as well. Now then, before Rumuru ended the meeting, Diablo will provide some updates regarding his former mission, such as Amarus is currently teaching Yom lessons on noble etiquette, and the new King Edward has started to reorganize their armies for mobilization. Apparently, Diablo was the one secretly helping King Edward to quicken the process because he found the mission to be tedious and had wanted to resolve the matter as soon as possible. Diablo has already requested for Benimaru to start organizing their own forces when the time is right, much to Rumuru's surprise since they're both treating this entire mission like a simple hiking trip. However, the most important point of Diablo's report was that Rahim still hasn't reported back after he was sent to the Western Holy Church with Rumuru's message, although much of what was presented in the episode were not that different from the light novel. But since Diablo reassures Rumuru that nothing bad has happened to Rahim despite the lack of communication, he decides to ignore it for now, although internally, they are still worried about the uncertain nature on the matter because of the limited information they have, and let's just say that his intuition on Rahim will be correct in upcoming episodes. Nonetheless, everyone seems to have the same sentiment on wanting to end the dispute with the Western Holy Church as soon as possible, and in the light novel, it was even stated that currently, now that Rumuru has become part of the Octagram, they only have to worry about two hostile factions, the Holy Church and the Eastern Empire, who hasn't really made any moves yet, hence the reason why Tempest was mainly focusing on dealing with the Holy Church. Regardless, the following discussion in the anime about the motives of the supposed mastermind responsible for the incidents that happened to Tempest pretty much followed the light novel. But to quickly summarize what they said, they initially believed that all the incidents were connected and orchestrated by the same person, the master that Claimer mentioned during Walpurgis. However, Rumuru soon realized that there is more than a single party involved, which is somewhat true, and everything only seems to be connected due to pure coincidence, since they all had the same goal, to destroy Temper, so the various factions simply worked together to achieve this. For instance, Claimer instigating the former kingdom to attack Tempest because Rumuru has been interfering with his plans, and he wanted to use the casualties from the war to awaken into a true demon lord, the former kingdom choosing to invade Tempest for the potential wealth they have, Hinata ambushing Rumuru outside of Ingratia was to stop him from returning to Tempest, but also to avenge Shizu, and the Western Holy Church sending their paladins to help the Farmer's army invade Tempest since having a nation full of monsters went against their doctrines. And because they aren't directly working together, when Rumuru overcame all the issues, they were now forced to focus on their own personal interests instead. It was for this reason that Rumuru claims the Master Claimer referred to won't be making a move anytime soon, and since King Amarus has already abdicated from the throne, it only leaves the response of Hinata and the Western Holy Church that Tempest has to worry about. That's why Rumuru was worried about the status of Rahim, knowing they might somehow use Rahim as a scapegoat to wage another war. But having said that, going into some very heavy spoilers, even though Winston King Raphael does predict the possibility of multiple parties being involved, and they likely aren't working together anymore for this upcoming conflict with the former kingdom or the Western Holy Church, it's only partially true because everything that happened so far can basically be traced back to a single entity, the Eastern Empire. And what I mean by this is the Eastern merchants were actually the ones responsible for telling King Amaris about the potential profits of Tempest if they took control, tricking Hinata into believing that Rimuru murdered Shizu, and providing Claymont with the means to acquire more power. However, what was their true motives? While in the light novel, the Eastern Empire has always wanted to invade the Western nations, but with the appearance of Tempest, they quickly became a dangerous force that stands in between the territorial ambitions of the Empire. That's why they sent merchants to instigate the Western Holy Church, Demolock Claymont, and the former kingdom into attacking Tempest. And the anime even gives us a confirmation of this when Rimuru orders Diablo and Shuna to investigate further about the merchants involved, despite not outright revealing they were actually from the Empire. Also, they hope that Rimuru might kill Hinata or vice versa during their previous fight, as it would greatly weaken the fighting strength of the Western nations and destabilize them. And even if the anime would like us to believe that Yuki Kagurazaka is the true mastermind, he was also being manipulated by the Empire. But I digress, not much else can be said about the discussion in the episode since it follows the light novel exactly, although we can look forward to the next episode because it's Hinata's turn, and it will have some heavy implications for the series. Furthermore, I have seen people complaining about the constant meetings and talking between characters, not understanding that Tensura has always focused more on the world building and character interactions, with the action simply being an accompanying aspect. Additionally, everything they mention are actually important as they all have their own payoff moments, and it serves to provide context as well as a story setup for future events. But what are your thoughts on this matter? Do you like the exposition or do you find it tedious to follow? Let me know your personal opinions in the comments down below. Anyways, episode 4 is a bit heavier in terms of the info dump than the previous one, but overall, it still managed to feel entertaining with the right amount of humor and world-building elements. This episode also has very little cut content to talk about since, like I said, most of the details provided were quite important to the story. But what do you like about the episode so far? Feel free to share your favorite moments and opinions on the episode down below. Also, if you enjoyed this cut content video, remember to leave a like, don't forget to subscribe to the channel and hit that notification button for more cut content videos as well. Thanks for watching, and as always, stay safe everyone.